Let's go to verse 1. Well, let's start reading with chapter 1, verse 14. We'll start there. Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to render service for the sake of those who will inherit salvation? Who are they talking about? Angels. So now let's continue to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1. For this reason, we must pay closer attention to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away from it. For if the word spoken through angels proved unalterable, that word there for unalterable is the word bebaios in the Greek. Bebaios, B-E-B-A-I-O-S, if you want to take notes. We will come back to it, but just write it down. And every transgression and disobedience received a just penalty. How will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? After it was at the first spoken through the Lord, it was confirmed to us by those who heard, God also testifying with them, both by signs and wonders, and by various miracles, and by gifts. Do you have gifts in your Bible?
Yes.
Okay, that word gifts, scratch through it, and rewrite it with the word distributions. The word is merismos in the Greek, and that is distributions, not gifts. Of the Ruach HaKodesh, of the Holy Spirit, according to His own will. Everybody with me? Verse 5. For He did not subject to angels the world to come, concerning which we are speaking. So we're talking of what time? The future, right? He did not subject to angels the world to come, concerning which we are speaking. But one has testified somewhere, what is man that you remember him? Or a son of man, not the son of man, it is a son of man. So change the thee to a. A son of man that you are concerned about him. Verse 7. You have made him for a little while lower than angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and have appointed him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in subjecting all things to him, he has left nothing that is not subject to him. Everybody with me? But now we do not see yet all things subjected to him, but we do see him who was made for a little while lower than the angels, namely Yeshua, because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. So verse 7 through 8 is talking about who? Who is verse 7 and 8 talking about? Jesus. We talked about it last week. Verse 7 and 8 is talking about?
Angels.
Huh?
Jesus.
Man. Go back to 7. For you made him for a little while lower than the angels. Who's that? Man. Because remember the verse before that is, what is man that you remember him? Or a son of man that you are concerned about him? That is the question. Now he's answering that question. You have made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor.
What church are you reading from?
Nazareth.
Because my Bible doesn't say anything about for a little while. Not the King James.
What does it say in verse 7?
God made him a little lower than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor. But it doesn't say for a little while.
I don't know. I don't know the Greek, my sister. You have to ask Georgie. And have appointed him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. Right? For in subjecting all things to him, he left nothing that is not subject to him. But what happened? We do not see yet all things subjected to him. Who is that? Man. God put everything under the feet of man, but guess what? Right now, if you look, you don't see that in reality. Correct? Then he says, but, the second part of it, we do see him who was made a little lower, for a little while lower than the angels, namely Yeshua. So we're now talking specifically about Jesus. Yeah. He was made a man. So he was little lower than angels for a little while, because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. So now let's go to verse 1. For this reason, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. What reason? It said, for this reason. You see that? What is the reason? So remember, in the last week we said there are we submitted our positive proof that Yeshua was higher than the angels. Correct? So what were the angels when we discussed them last week? They are ministering spirits. Remember? They are servants who are serving. Malak means messenger. So now, what reason is it that we must pay closer attention? Let's go back to the previous verse.
I was going to say, because they said they are not all.
Are they not all ministering spirits? So now we're going to talk about what these ministering spirits said. That's what we're going to go into. Okay? Now let's take it one at a time. Hebrews 2:1, I'm going to say it again. It says that we must pay closer attention to. What is it that we're going to have to pay closer attention to? To what we have heard. What is it that we have heard? What have you and I heard? We need to pay closer attention to what we have heard. What is it that you and I have heard? We have heard two things. We have heard the Torah, and we have heard the gospel message. By this time, by the writing of this book, both messages were out. Right? Yeshua's story was out. The Torah was already given. So what they're saying is, what we have heard is both of them. Don't misunderstand me. It is not just Yeshua. It is not just Torah. But it is both. For if the word spoken through angels proved unalterable, and every transgression and disobedience received a just penalty. What is the message spoken through angels? What is it that, hear this very carefully, that every transgression of disobedience received a what? A just penalty. What is the message that was received from angels that if you disobeyed, you got a just penalty? What was the message? Spoken through angels, that if you disobeyed, you got a just penalty. It was the Torah. Now we've got to prove why we say it was angels, but hold on to that piece. Now, here's an interesting thing. If you look at this verse, it says, go back to that verse. Verse 2, for if the word spoken through angels proved unalterable, what does the word unalterable mean? Unchangeable. Okay? Immutable. Alter, change. So unalterable, unchangeable. So if the word spoken through angels proved unchangeable, and every transgression, what's a transgression? If you disobey and break a law, that's transgression. And every breaking of that law and disobedience received a just punishment. Next part, look at this carefully. How will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? So it's speaking from the lower to the higher. This is a rabbinic method of argument. It's used by rabbis for decades, for centuries. Here's what he's saying. If the Torah that was spoken through angels was unchangeable, the Son of God, which we have already said is higher than the angels, what he has spoken is so much more important that if you break what the angels said and you would get a penalty for it, how much more for what the Son of God said? You understand what I'm saying? It is from the lower angel to the higher, the argument that he's making. Now, very important argument to make. If a lot of churches that would teach Hebrews, they will teach you that this was written, this book was written, this letter was written to a bunch of Jewish people who became Christians and now were going back to the practice of Torah. Okay? They were planning to go back to the practice of Torah. Okay, this is what the normal teaching is across the church. Because the Torah had been done away with. There is no more need for Torah. So these Jewish people were going back to Torah, and that was not required. But let me ask you a dumb question. If the Torah was or had already become useless to these people, does this argument hold true?
No.
If these people said, forget the Torah, finished, cut off, over, now I want Jesus, does the Torah anymore have value? No. But what the writer is saying is, if that Torah was unalterable, how much more? So they were holding Torah at a very high level. If not, this argument doesn't hold water. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Okay, let me put it this way. Did the first church follow the Mosaic law?
Yes.
Yes. Good answer.
Yes.
Let me go through some things that I did real quick to give you an idea about what I'm trying to say. Did the first group go to the temple?
Yes.
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 Huh? Yes, no, maybe so.
Yes, yes, yes.
Acts chapter 3, verse 1. And you can go Acts chapter 2, verse 46. We all want to go back to the first century church. Well, what did they do?
Peter always went back to the Old Testament.
Time of prayer.
Okay, number 2. Were they devoted to prayer? What were the prayers? They have Amida. They have the Kaddish. They have the Jewish prayer service. An example of this is again Acts chapter 3, verse 1. Let's go to Acts 3, 1 real quick to read this. I want you to understand who these people are. Acts chapter 3, verse 1.
Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at that
where
hour.
Where Peter and John were going up to the temple
at the hour of prayer.
At the hour of prayer. What is the hour of prayer? In the morning and evening, they would put the incense on the altar. And when they put the incense on the altar, there's a 1 hour period of prayer. This is why we have the song called Sweet Hour of Prayer. You know that song? It comes from this root. So they used to go, and what were the prayers that were being said? They are not the church prayers we say today. They were the rabbinic prayers. Because at that time, we didn't have Billy Graham or any of those people to preach and pray for them. Number 3, they broke bread. Correct? Is this a Christian concept or is it a Jewish concept? This is a very Jewish concept.
Yeah.
Understand this, okay? Acts chapter 2, verse 46 again. Number 4, and here's one thing. They were zealous for the law. I don't know what people would say about this. Go to Acts chapter 21, verse 20. Read it for yourself. I don't want to put words in people's mouth. Go to Acts chapter 21, verse 20. See what it said.
And when they heard it, they glorified God. And
the people who were the believers glorified God.
And they said to him, You see, brother, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed. They are zealous for the law.
So there are thousands of Jewish believers who have come to accept Yeshua, but not only that, they are zealous for the law. These are believers who are zealous for the law. This is the first testament, the first century church. Next one. They kept them, some of them, they even kept a Nazarite vow. You know what a Nazarite vow is? That he was not going to cut your hair for a period of time. Okay? Go to Acts, pardon this, Acts 21, 24. At the end of the vow, what they will do is they will shave their head and take the hair and give it to the temple. This is the end of the Nazarite vow. But before that, they have to go through what is called a purification process. Do you go to any church and have your hair shaved off and go through a purification process? No. This is believers we're talking about. Okay? Next. They took part in the temple sacrifice. Temple service. You know what temple service is? Avodah. It means the sacrificial system. Okay? You can go home and read Acts 21, 26. Now, they went to synagogue on Sabbath. Acts 18, 19. Circumcision for the Jews. Remember, Paul took Timothy, whose one of his parents was Jewish, and what did he do? Circumcised him. This was Paul. Okay? Acts 16, 3. They kept the feast. Did Paul keep the feast? Go to Acts 18, verse 21. Acts 18, 21. Somebody?
But taking leave of them and saying, I will return to you again if God wills. He set sail from Ephesus. 18:21.
Paul is saying that I have to go to Jerusalem to keep the feast. 18:20, where he said, I have to go to Jerusalem to keep the feast. Maybe I misquoted. Where? Which verse? Okay, what does it say?
For faith and favor, saying I must by all means keep the peace that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will.
18:21? Is that what you read?
NASB.
What did yours say? 18:21.
Acts 18:21. But taking leave of them and saying, I will return to you again if God wills.
What is 20? Verse 20?
And when they asked him to stay for a longer time, he did not consent.
What did he say?
He did not consent.
Taking
leave of them and saying, I will return to you again,
but
if God wills.
So yours, you have, I must keep the
peace
in that.
I must by all means keep the peace that cometh to Jerusalem.
Which version is that?
That's King James. But it is in the King James. This is interesting. The Greek expert has to look into this. Now, he is saying, well, according to the King James, Paul is saying, I have to keep the feast in Jerusalem. Okay, so at least there is three pilgrimage feasts. He is saying, I have to keep the feast. This is Paul. And lastly, they had the purification. We just had E.J. read the purification portion. Correct? Again, Acts 24, 18, or Acts 21:26. But all this is proving something, that the first church had a very close association with what we say today is finished. All this is from the book of Acts. And Acts is Acts of the Apostles. So I'm quoting something that is saying, hey, this is what they believed. Do you understand what I'm saying? So what I'm saying is, if God was spoken through angels, this portion had not become obsolete. How much more unchangeable is the word that comes from the Son? Now the question becomes, what does this have to do with angels? Is that the question you're all asking me?
But we want a little bit. So are you saying that we as Christians should be doing all of that?
No, because there is no temple. Without the temple, you cannot take part in the sacrificial system. You cannot do a Nazarite vow. You can't do the temple service. You cannot go. You don't have to be circumcised because you're not Jewish. You don't have purification laws. All these are gone. But what I'm saying is, to the Jew of the time, these were all valid to him. You are a Gentile. You don't have all these things that you have to keep. But as a Jew, they still kept it in the first century. So to them, the law that was given through Moses was not done away with. It was very much part of their life. What I'm trying to prove is, this was not done away with. Okay? The reason you're not keeping some of these things, you cannot go to the temple. Even if you went, they'd throw you out because you're Gentile. You're not allowed to go in the temple. Okay? You cannot be Zebulun. You cannot have a Nazarite vow. It's not possible. You cannot go to the temple, sir. These things do not exist. Okay? I'm trying to prove is, there are some denominations out there that say this whole thing, baby out with the, they're throwing the baby out with the bathwater, saying this is all done away with. And if this is all done away with, then this argument from the lower to the higher doesn't hold water. So these people believed in this. And now what the writer of Hebrews is saying is, wait a minute, you believe in all this stuff, which was given through angels. If this stuff is important, that it was given through angels and not changeable, how much more important is the one that we have proven is higher than angels when he speaks? You follow what I'm saying? This is lower stuff. The higher stuff is the Son of God, who's higher than all the guys who gave all this stuff. You understand? So the whole premise that this is all done away with goes out the window. Now, the question we all ask is, was the Old Testament given by angels? Did you just read? What did it say? Verse 2. For if the word spoken through angelos, through angels proved unalterable, so what word was spoken through angels? Through angels?
Handed over to Moses.
Where does it say that?
No, God gave it directly to Moses, so that's what's confusing.
Ah, that's what confuses everybody. How are angels fitting into this equation where God gave the law to Moses? Because the words of the Torah are, God spoke these to Moses. That's what the Torah said. Okay, let's go to Acts chapter 7, verse 53. We have a guy by the name of Stephen, who is actually giving a history of what has happened. And so let's go to Acts chapter 7, verse 53, and see what it says.
You who received the law as ordained by angels.
You who received the law as ordained by
angels. And yet did not keep it.
That's nasty. Now, sister, why don't you read what it is written in the King James?
Who have received the law by the disposition of angels.
By the disposition of angels. What is it? Disposition? Giving. So this is saying that God gave the law through angels. Go to your verse, Galatians 3:19. Part, the first part, Galatians 3:19.
While the law then, it was added because of transgressions, having been ordained through angels by the agency of a mediator.
So it was given by the agency of angels. Did you know that? Now if you read the Torah, nowhere in the Torah does it say it came from the angels. But we just read that Stephen, Paul, they all said it comes from angels.
So who was that roaring up on that mountain?
Who was up on the mountain?
Yes, with Moses making all that noise.
I am glad you asked. Go to Psalm chapter 68, verse 17. Who was on the mountain making all the noise? Glad you asked. Psalm, I love EJ. She just comes up and just gives you the crux of it. What is going on? Psalm 68, verse 17. Who was on the mountain?
The chariots of God are myriads, thousands upon thousands. The Lord is among them as at Sinai in holiness.
So God came down on Mount Sinai, but along with him, now here's what the King James said. This is interesting. EJ, you can read this in the King James. Read.
What verse is that?
68:17.
17, okay. Okay. The chariots of God and 20,000.
The chariots of God are 20,000. Remember, in Ezekiel's vision, he saw one chariot. Remember? With the wheels turning and God is descending. There are 20,000 chariots on Mount Sinai. And then read the rest of it.
Even thousands of angels.
So thousands of angels came along with the 20,000 chariots. So what happened is all of heaven's angels and hosts along with God showed up in Mount Sinai. So this was not just God alone. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 2. Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 2.
The Lord came from Sinai. And dawned on them from Seir. He shone forth from Mount Paran. And he came from the midst of 10,000 holy ones.
Did you see that? He came from the midst of 10,000 holy ones.
At his right hand there was flashing lightning for them.
Okay, in the Septuagint. Now remember, this is what the writer of Hebrews is using. The Septuagint. At his right hand, there were angels. The word is angelos. So what happened? God descends on Mount Sinai. So when God descended, guess what? This is an interaction with man. Angels were so in awe, they said, we are going to. So the whole host of heaven showed up on Mount Sinai. The whole host of heaven showed up on Mount Sinai. Can you believe that? That will make a whole lot of noise, right? Now, we will stop right here for just a minute, and then we will come back and pick it up.